News of the day.
Mr. Zimmerman, have you made a decision as to whether or not you want to testify in this case?
With values that never die.
There are certainly a lot of controversies or scandals brewing right now when it comes to the Obama administration.
This is American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
Dealing with the federal government is not always high tech, and it's not always user-friendly.
The stories that matter.
This is a massive escalation in the tension here in Egypt.
The issues that count.
I don't know why the media tries to make this into a sensation. We have never hidden the fact that we supply Syria with weapons.
This is American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
He's got the red, white, blue, flying high on the farm. Semper Fi tattooed on his left arm. Spend a little more in the store for a tag in the back.
American Heartland with Dr. Grace. I am your host, the editor of Politics and Culture at WorldTribune.com. Every week on this show, we uphold values that will never, ever die. And this week, we are jubilant because the truth is coming out. One of my favorite expressions that I coined myself is the truth has a very big mouth. If you've been listening to this show since its inception, you know that we have been reporting on Benghazi over and over again, and we have contested the White House's version of events. At last, this week, a double whammy. There are 450 pages of previously top secret documents that have now been revealed, and in addition, a bipartisan Senate report was completed. All of the evidence coming forward does two things. Number one, it establishes clearly and unequivocally that the President of the United States knew the nature of the attack really early on. Within 15 minutes of the attack on our compound in Benghazi, Leon Panetta had been briefed of events. He was then the Secretary of Defense. He went on to speak to the president shortly thereafter, and he told the president the nature of the attack. Clearly and unequivocally, it was a terrorist attack. Everything that came out of the closed-door sessions that are now being revealed, including the Senate's own investigation, the bipartisan panel, everyone on the ground was on the same page. Everybody understood from Gregory Hicks right on up the chain of command that it was a terrorist attack. And nowhere, I repeat, nowhere and no one mentioned or said anything about some protest inspired by some video, some protest that went amok. It was clearly a terrorist attack on 9/11. So what does this mean? The president lied to the American people. He lied brazenly. He lied openly. He lied shamelessly. He lied repeatedly. But to all of you, this is now just part of a pattern that you have seen unfolding. He lied on Benghazi the same way that he lied about Obamacare. He is a liar. And the facts are revealing that. The facts are now incontrovertible. Remember, he tried to quash all of this by saying that it was one big phony scandal. Again, another lie. By no means phony. He knew about it on the eve, early on that night. He knew the nature of the attack. He knew what it was. And because he was so concerned about his reelection prospects, he lied to the American people. He tried to concoct a story, and it was transparent to many of us, and we cried foul, and we are now vindicated. So that was the whole, that was point number one that has come out of all of this. And the second point that has come out of all of this is that repeatedly, people on the ground were telling the State Department that more security was needed. And the State Department did not follow through. The State Department did not want to accept the reports that were coming on the ground, and we don't quite know why, but adequate security was not given to our ambassador. Do you remember that last year when we covered this story, we sounded the alarm on this show because there was some person, a key individual, and he is a Marine Colonel, George Bristol. We were crying out, where is George Bristol? We need you to testify. And the Pentagon was stonewalling. The Pentagon was saying, we can't find him. We don't know where he is. But shows like this, we kept pressing and pressing. You find that guy and you get him to testify. And he did testify. And you know what he said? It's there now in the transcripts in black and white. He warned the State Department that an attack in Libya on that compound was likely to happen. And he was ignored. And the head of AFRICOM, General Carter Ham, also had the same testimony in closed-door sessions that he had issued warnings to the State Department. So the verdict is in. The State Department was woefully negligent. This attack could have and should have been prevented. And there's another myth that's been propagated that somehow the intelligence, the CIA dropped the ball on this. No, the CIA knew. The CIA was warning that the facility was weak, needed more protection, and there were dangerous elements swirling all around. And so the Obama administration and then Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, they are now indicted by the facts and by the American people. You knew what was happening on that night and you lied to the American people, and that is unacceptable. And even worse, you were warned that it could happen. You were warned again and again to provide more security, and both of you did not. Shame on both of you. You have the blood of those Americans on your hands. And you know, this is absolutely an outrageous occurrence. If the truth had been known in 2012, it is highly likely that the president would not have been reelected. And so this entire second term is built on a lie, a faulty reelection campaign. And that is why there is no blessing. The president has been mired in gridlock, in part because the entire reelection campaign was built on dissemination. And all of us who have been saying, look at Benghazi, we've been vilified again and again, and yet this week we stand victorious. The truth has now come out, and everyone who said to the contrary owes all of us an apology. Well, what has happened this week? McCain went on the Senate floor and he started to blast the media for failing to have previously reported the truth about Benghazi. In particular, he took aim at the New York Times. The New York Times very recently came out with a large report, essentially mouthing off or trying to prove the talking points of the Obama administration. Well, Senator McCain rightfully said that the New York Times based its report on myth and not on facts. Roll it, Brittany.
The latest snow job came in December from the New York Times, that ever-reliable surrogate of the Obama administration, which published a long report challenging some key facts about the Benghazi attack. But as Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan used to say, everyone is entitled to their own opinion, but not to their own facts, and the facts are stubborn things. In reality, what the Times report does is propagate myths. Let's review some of the facts.
The New York Times has been nothing but a shill for this administration. And there is no starker example of that than that bogus report that Mr. Kirkpatrick put together. In particular, the New York Times was trying to promote the idea that Al-Qaeda was not involved in the attack. Another blatant lie. I don't care what you call that, the name of the group. They were obviously affiliated with Al-Qaeda. And the New York Times wants to bury that word because they know that if in the public mind Al-Qaeda is linked with Benghazi, it means that the president lied about what he had achieved. By killing Osama bin Laden, he thereafter claimed that he had basically decapitated Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda was on the run. And yet, just before he was elected, Al-Qaeda had scored a huge victory against the United States. And so the New York Times wants to bury that word Al-Qaeda in affiliation with Benghazi. But not so. All the reports coming forward indicate clearly and unequivocally the group that attacked that compound was an affiliate of Al-Qaeda. Shorthand, Al-Qaeda struck America again. Roll it, Brittany.
Here are the facts. Al-Qaeda-affiliated groups were present in Benghazi. And they were involved in the attack of September 11, 2012. The New York Times itself reported on October 29, 2012, and I quote, American officials said the attack included participants from Ansar al-Sharia, Al-Qaeda, in the Islamic Maghreb, and the Mohammed Jamal Network, a militant group in Egypt. All of these groups are affiliated with Al-Qaeda.
Yes, they're affiliated with Al-Qaeda, as clear as day. Another fact that they've been trying to bury. But this week we got a huge victory because even the lamestream media was forced to report on the bipartisan panel. Listen to NBC. Roll it, Brittany.
The night 16 months ago on the 9/11 anniversary when four Americans were killed, including our ambassador to Libya. It's back in the news tonight because of a scathing report just issued by the Senate Intelligence Committee. It says the deaths could have been prevented by better security, better communication. And the State Department, they say, gets most of the blame.
So even Brian Williams has to admit that the report is scathing and that the conclusion by this bipartisan panel is that the deaths could have been preventable. And who is ultimately responsible for what happened? The State Department. Andrea Mitchell confirmed that in her report. Roll it, Brittany.
Says the attacks that killed the four Americans, including Ambassador Chris Stevens, were preventable. In fact, hundreds of intelligence reports in prior months had warned militias and terrorists and affiliated groups had the capability and intent to strike U.S. and Western facilities and personnel in Libya.
The intelligence was really ample. I had an opportunity to review it myself.
Was it the State Department that should have ramped up the security with all these warnings, the CIA, or both?
It's the State Department that's responsible for the security of our missions and embassies.
There it is. It's the State Department, and another way of saying that is Hillary Clinton is responsible for what happened on 9/11. That attack on the Benghazi compound. Disgraceful. A disgraceful spectacle by both the president and his secretary of state. And that is why by 10 a.m. that evening, the two of them were on the phone and the State Department shortly thereafter posted a bogus story about a video. You know why? Because both of them were responsible for what happened. They knew it immediately, and they knew they had to cover it up as quickly and as best as they could. Well, they didn't get away with it. And today on American Heartland, we are so happy to report that if you fight and fight and fight for the truth, ultimately the truth sees the light of day. You are listening to Dr. Grace, the editor of Politics and Culture at WorldTribune.com. And we here uphold values that will never ever die, and we uphold the truth as it comes forward.
Don't you know, things can change, things will go your way, if you hold on for one more day. Can you hold on for one more day, things will go your way. Hold on for one more day.
The stories that matter, the issues that count. This is American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
You're listening to the best of American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
This is American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
I've been living and fast forward. Hillbilly rock star out of control. I've been living and fast forward.
Welcome back to American Heartland with Dr. Grace. I'm the editor of Politics and Culture at WorldTribune.com. And this week, I think you were all pressing that fast forward button during the president's snoozer of a State of the Disunion address. I was dreading it. In fact, my husband has been ill all week, and we have cuddled up and watched a couple of movies commiserating together. And yet we did take some time to watch the State of Disunion address, and it was just as dreadful as I anticipated that it would be. And it looks like the American people also agree with me, because by and large, the ratings were horrible. About 33 million people tuned in, which is one of the lowest ratings, one of the lowest amount of people to tune in to a State of the Union address since about the year 2000. There's been a steady decline in interest in the State of the Union address. And that's because, for the most part, it's full of claptrap. And also, if we compare last year's State of the Union with this year's State of the Union, we saw that so much of what the president said he was going to do, he wasn't able to accomplish. So the State of the Union sounds to Americans like a bunch of blah, 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 and please elect me next year or whenever the next election is. In fact, I said at the time, right as I was listening, this sounds much more like a campaign speech rather than truly the State of the Union. I thought that the president made a couple of very big mistakes because he didn't address directly, forthrightly, what is foremost on everybody's mind. It's almost as though he was giving last year's or the previous year's State of the Union address, because what I wanted him to talk about is all of the revelations about how our privacy is undermined with the NSA snooping that we know exists in this country. He should be addressing it because that is a national crisis. And he should have addressed in much more detail than he did the tremendous problems going forward with Obamacare and the entire health insurance industry. He talked about that ever so briefly. He gave a defense of his policies. He pointed out to a woman that had a pre-existing condition and benefited greatly from it, et cetera, et cetera. But it was, in my view, wholly unconvincing. And then he went on, the narcissist that he is, to talk about what he's going to do regardless of congressional approval and oversight. He's got his phone and he's got his pen, and he's going to use his executive authority to maximize whatever he can on behalf of the agenda that he has laid out. It was overall a display in extreme hubris and arrogance and a lack of touch with the concerns of the American people. Even when he spoke about the economy, he talked about all of the gains that had been made, but he downplayed the very damning statistics. The number of people who no longer looking for work because they have given up. So in essence, this president tried to present a rosy colored portrait of America, and it fell flat. So much so that many Democrats continue to distance themselves from him, Senate Democrats in particular, who are up for election in red and purple states. And they immediately stepped back in many of the commentaries, many of the interviews that they gave. They took a step back from the president, tried to show some distance between their view of things and his. And that shows you how it was essentially a really insignificant speech. The one thing that is significant, that does stand out, is now this pattern of the imperial presidency. His willingness to exceed the constitutional powers that he has. This is extremely alarming and something we all got to keep a very watchful eye on. Now, here you have a president that is on the ropes, that has just delivered an abysmal State of the Union speech. And what is the Republican response? Instead of coming forward, addressing the issues that I've just laid out in front of the American people, and highlighting what a failure this administration is, they sent out this representative, Representative McMorris Rogers, a very nice lady by all accounts. She delivered the response and she talked about building a nicer, stronger, sweeter middle class, empowering individuals, etc., etc. I thought that this was another mistake by the Republican Party. Yes, she's a nice lady,
but I do not think she hit the right tone. The American people are angry, and we need somebody to express that anger and that frustration. The response should have been a very forceful indictment of the President of the United States. The GOP response should have been something like, "My fellow Americans, I stand before you today in shock and dismay at the lies that this president told the American people. We know now clearly and unequivocally that he lied about Obamacare. He lied about the coverage that would be given. He lied about the possibility of keeping one's doctor and keeping one's health care. In addition, my fellow Americans, we know through a bipartisan Senate report that the very foundation of his reelection was built on a lie. He lied about Benghazi. In addition, my fellow Americans, we have yet seen any accountability on the IRS scandal that threatens each and every one of us going forward. Furthermore, there have been some shocking revelations by Edward Snowden about the invasion of privacy, which threatens to undermine each and every one of our liberties. All of these issues and more reveals that this president has failed us. He is embarking on a road of diplomacy with Iran when we should be tough with Iran. He is weakening American power abroad in an alarming way, and he is destroying our Constitution by attempting to use executive power willy-nilly instead of going through Congress to enact legislation. We must remove this man from office as quickly as possible." You see, that's the kind of thing that would have awakened Americans. Americans would say, "Yes, you're speaking for me and my concerns right now." Instead, they're playing on Obama's turf. When you talk about the middle class, you're talking like Obama talks. Don't divide us according to class and race and gender. Talk to us as Americans who share similar concerns regarding our economy, our health, our national defense, and the state of the government. Now, Rand Paul gave a speech on YouTube. He gave his version of a response, and I want you to listen to a couple of snippets of it. One of the first things he says is that if we're going to overcome the economic downturn, we have to understand the cause of that downturn. Roll it, Brittany.
"Too much government money was given out to too many borrowers who could not afford the payments. Banks were encouraged by government to lend money on houses with no money down. The demand for houses went up, and so did their prices, but it was unsustainable. Millions of people lost their jobs. If we don't understand the cause of joblessness, we'll have trouble fixing it. As we entered into the Great Recession, Republicans and Democrats misdiagnosed the problem as too little government, so they gave us more government in the form of bank bailouts and a government stimulus plan. Nearly $1 trillion later, though, we find that government doesn't create jobs very well. It turned out that it cost nearly $400,000 per job created. Why? Because government is inherently bad at picking winners and losers. In the marketplace, most small businesses fail. If government is to send money to certain people to create businesses, they will more often than not pick the wrong people, and no jobs will be created. Think of the $500 million President Obama gave to Solyndra to build solar panels. Turns out, people didn't want to buy these solar panels, and the taxpayer lost that money. Think of the billions spent on the war on poverty over many decades. Government spending doesn't work."
Well, Mr. Paul is on the right track when he identifies as the cause of the problem. But his tone is so deadpan and uninspiring. I mean, where's the passion? Where's the outrage that we Americans feel? If you compare the way that Obama talks versus the way somebody like Rand Paul talks, Obama knows how to inject a lot of emotion. I disagree with his policies, but I can see how he can stir his base and stir his followers. Rand Paul is right, but there's no passion, there's no emotion, there's no eloquence. And even when he's talking about something like Solyndra, where's the outrage? And why don't you identify the cronyism that went on? Personalize the issue a bit more. He went on to talk about the incredible debt that has been incurred and all of the joblessness in our society. Listen to the next segment.
His idea is that we should make it easier to funnel federal dollars back to local governments. I think it would be better not to take the money from the businesses in the first place. We need real jobs created in the real world, not more empty government promises. Under President Obama, the percentage of people working is at its lowest level since the days of Jimmy Carter. Roughly 11 million people are unemployed, and millions more have given up looking for work. Our debt has nearly doubled since President Obama entered office and is now over $17 trillion. Our credit rating has been downgraded. Spending continues at unsustainable levels, and we're borrowing more than $1 million every minute. But the numbers tell only half the story. Parents worry about their children going up in a country where good jobs are few and far between.
And again, he is dead right in what he says. But where is the outrage? Where is the passion? When he talks about the downgrading of America's credit rating, put that in context. It's the first time in American history that that has happened. And explain to the American people just how bad it is and what that means. Don't just recite a bunch of statistics. People don't relate to statistics. You have to personalize the problem. And that comes from the passion and emotion that you've got to feel as you explain that problem. He then goes on to talk about the reforms that we should enact. Listen to this.
Mr. President, where are the jobs? You spent nearly $1 trillion on make-work government jobs, and still joblessness confronts the next generation. As a country, all of us together must ask, are we better off when we borrow money from China? Are we better off when we print more money to pass around, hoping no one will notice that the emperor has no clothes? The illusion wears thin. It's time we choose another path. Government spending sounds great, but what good is a welfare program that leaves people embittered, resentful, and trapped, unable to climb into the middle class? What is the virtue in making people feel hopeless, like they can't build a good life in America anymore? Hope and change needs to be more than just a slogan.
And he's right once again. And what he should do in a speech is identify somebody, for example, who believed in the hope and change and voted for the president. And tell us about that story and how it went wrong so we can relate to that, emote with that. And he goes on to list all of the things that the Republican Party can do better if they're in power. Roll it, Brittany.
Lower taxes, less regulation will entice money and jobs to return home. Americans want opportunity, a chance to work again. I fully believe that most Americans hate the trap of government dependency, but can't break free because big government gives them no exit. I believe a better tomorrow is around the corner if we can see beyond those who entice us with the easy way out. Hard work and sweat invigorate the spirit and provide a solace no government program will ever achieve. We must choose a new way, a way that empowers the individual through education and responsibility to earn a place alongside their fellow Americans in the most prosperous nation ever conceived. America has much greatness left in her. We must believe in ourselves, believe in our founding documents, believe in our future, and then we will thrive again. Thank you, and God bless America.
You know, again, very well-meaning, but just not good enough. The Republican Party has been talking about lowering taxes, less regulation, less government dependency for years now, and they've not succeeded. Their track record is one also a failure. And unless they can show the American people that they're going to do different than they did before, they're not going to get anywhere. In my view, the Republicans are not capitalizing on the great, glaring failures of this president. And I still don't see a leader out there with the courage, the guts, and the eloquence to tell it like it is and outline a specific reform agenda that will smash the federal government and restore the liberties of the American people. You are listening to Dr. Grace, the editor of Politics and Culture at WorldTribune.com, upholding values that will never, ever die. I'll love you long after you're gone. For you. You will never sleep alone. I'll love you long after you're gone. And long after you're gone, gone, gone.
The stories that matter, the issues that count. This is American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
You're listening to the best of American Heartland with Dr. Grace. You're listening to the best of American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
This is American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
American Heartland with Dr. Grace. I'm your host, the editor of Politics and Culture at WorldTribune.com. Go to that website. It is awesome. Some of the best stories you will read anywhere. And also, if you're a fan of the show, every single episode is on YouTube. So you can follow us. You can hear everything we've said in the past, and you can hear everything we say now going forward again and again if you want to. Well, this week, the president made a very provocative statement. He basically said that if he can't get any legislation passed through Congress, he's prepared to use his executive authority to get things done. Roll it, Brittany.
And Senate members to try to continue to advance the economic recovery and to provide additional ladders of opportunity for everybody. But one of the things that I'll be emphasizing in this meeting is the fact that we are not just going to be waiting for legislation in order to make sure that we're providing Americans the kind of help that they need. I've got a pen and I've got a phone, and I can use that pen to sign executive orders and take executive actions and administrative actions that move the ball forward.
This is absolutely disgusting. The president is trying to provoke us all. His poll numbers are now slipping and slipping and slipping. He's now in the 30s once again. And it's no wonder that that's happening. It's because the media, right-wing media that is, folks like me, American Heartland, we and a bunch of others, are exposing this man every week, every month, as a liar and as an incompetent. As a result, the people are seeing through him. And he's not able to get anything done in Congress. So what does he need to do? He needs to find a way to save his presidency, save his legacy. So he makes this statement this week, which is he's not necessarily going to wait for legislation. Excuse me? Who died and made you dictator of the United States? All of us have to wait for legislation. You know, there's a lot of things that I personally would like, but I have a pen and I have a phone and I can't make it happen. Why? Because I'm a member of a republic. Well, I have to wait for elections. I have to wait for my party to pick up the piece of legislation that I want, an election to occur, and Congress to pass the bill. That's how it works for all of us. He's not a god. He's not greater than any of us. He is one cog of our electoral process. One cog, and that's it. That's what the founding fathers did when they created our Constitution. You disperse power. You create checks and balances. You make sure that each branch of government has limited powers and limited authority. In the executive branch, he does have certain prerogatives, but he does not have the right to willy-nilly transform or enact legislation without congressional approval. So the question we have to ask is this. Look, he is a constitutional expert. He used to teach the Constitution. In fact, he was one of those individuals that railed against the previous president, saying that he was abusing his executive power. So he and liberals, they know these arguments very, very well. So what is going on here? Why is he doing it? Well, there are two reasons. One is he does need to show some kind of record of achievement in order to gin up support in the midterms and for his party in 2016. And he's sadly lacking that. He's not been able to get anything done. Unprecedented in terms of the kind of gridlock that has occurred in Washington and how his agenda has been totally blocked. So that's one reason. But another reason is this. He's a gambler. Right now, Obamacare is constantly in the headlines as a policy that has failed and failed abysmally. It's even becoming the butt of jokes. The website is the butt of jokes. And we now have not enough young invincibles enrolling in the program for it to be sustainable in the long run. So every day the news about Obamacare is really, really bad. And he and the Democrats know that they're going to get trounced in the midterm elections. They're not going to be able to hold on to the Senate, especially in red state and purple states. They have a number of candidates there that are going to be running, a number of incumbents. They're very, very vulnerable. And so the Democrats know that in order to hold on to the Senate, they have to change the conversation and they have to provoke the Republicans into some kind of misstep. My guess, reading what the president is doing, is that he thinks either way, this strategy is going to work for him. On the one hand, he'll be able to say that some things were done and that he, quote unquote, championed the people, even when Congress wasn't able to get legislation through. And on the other hand, even if there's an uproar, even if there's a backlash, even if the Republicans try to go down the road of talking about impeachment, he is going to be able to present himself as a victim, as somebody who, especially a man of race, a black man, a man of a black race, he's going to be able to present himself as somebody who was unduly stymied every time he tried to do something. He's going to try to play the victim card, the race card, anything and everything to change the conversation from his failed policies to Republican overreach. And that is why Republicans in handling this have to be extremely careful. Look, I am one of those folks who supported the government shutdown last year. And I thought that Ted Cruz did a magnificent job in the Senate with his long filibuster. And I think Ted Cruz has been vindicated by events. Yet, in this case, I now hear the murmurings of, if the president overreaches, should we begin impeachment proceedings? Well, I think perhaps we can start to threaten it, but I don't think we should take our eye off the ball. And the ball is this: win the Senate. Capture six more seats. That's all we need. And that will keep the president at bay for the last 2 years of his presidency, and that will basically confirms that his second term will be not what he envisioned. His agenda will have been completely blocked and stopped, and his expansion of government powers can at least be held at bay until hopefully we get a different president in 2016, a different kind of president, whether it be Republican or Democrat, one who will truly curtail the massive expansion of the federal government. So the president's comments are absolutely outrageous. They're disgusting. They're appalling. His use of executive power is deplorable. You'll remember that last year we covered a story by a leading scholar who said that the Constitution is basically something that was written by dead white males. It's archaic and we should ignore it. And I think the president's really beginning to embody that. He believes that. He actually dislikes our Constitution. But apart from that, he is a really good chess player when it comes to winning elections. Look at what he did in 2012. He knew that he had no record to run on. And so what he did was he vilified Mitt Romney and he lied about his record. And that's how he won re-election. And even if we know the truth now, he's still in power. He's still in office. And he's going to try to do the same kind of, play the same kind of games, enact some kind of tricks in order to prevent what everybody sees coming, which is an electoral tsunami in the midterms. So all of us, keep our eye on the ball. Keep our eye on those six seats. We must win them so that we can truly block this president's constant, incessant grab for more and more power. Well, his aura is gone. His charisma no longer captivates the American people. He has been unmasked, so much so that even folks at MSNBC, who always try to paint a rosy picture, are beginning to ask questions. Listen to what Chris Matthews has to say. Roll it, Brittany.
Let me get back to John Harman. How does this president regain his historic, heroic stature, which he had? I'm not saying he was ever super popular with more than 50-some percent of the country.
Right.
But he was seen as a hero to a lot of people, and I think he's lost that for a while. And I'm trying to figure out, how does he champion the election and re-election of his friends in the Senate, especially in the South, in red states, and that's what we're talking about here, even in the case of Kentucky and Georgia, Louisiana, Arkansas, North Carolina, all red states. Yeah. How does he go down? Like today, he's down to visit North Carolina and talk about unemployment, and Kay Hagan says he's in Washington, too busy to join him. It's only an hour ride on the plane.
Yeah.
You know, this is very strange from Chris Matthews' point of view. He talks about the president having heroic stature to some people in 2008. Well, that is true. Some people did see him as a messianic figure, as a hero. But it's not his job, Chris Matthews's, to try to ponder how the president should regain that. It's his job to analyze the facts. And the facts are that even though some people regarded him as a hero, quote unquote, in 2008, there was no basis for that heroism. What had he done? What had he achieved? What great legislative mark had he made prior to his first election? He had done very, very little. And many of us who looked at his record were saying that. So it's, to me, this statement by Chris Matthews is very, very telling. He's not interested in the truth of the matter. He's not interested in saying, well, look, there was people that saw him as a hero and they had no business seeing him as a hero back then. Instead, he continues to act as a sycophantic champion of this man, asking that question, well, how can he be a hero? How can we present him as a hero? In other words, how can we manufacture the image of a hero so we can get our Democrats reelected in the next election, in the midterms? This is appalling journalism by Chris Matthews. It is deplorable. It shows just how partisan he is and how unprofessional. He's violated all the rules of a professional reporter in this line of questioning. But what is also revealing is this. Look how the Democrats know what is at stake. The red states are vulnerable. Those candidates will be picked off in the midterms. And now they want to find a way to bolster the president's image so that he doesn't bring the whole ship down with him, because that is what's happening. And that is why someone like Kay Hagan stayed far away from the president when he went to visit North Carolina. It was a short ride, a plane ride away. She could have easily have been by his side. But instead, she wants to distance herself from him because he is now being seen clearly as a political loser. And if you associate yourself too closely with him, it's likely to drag down your chances of being reelected. And Democrats have seen this playbook before. Many of them, especially the Blue Dog Democrats, remember them. They're the moderates. They came to power with him in 2008. And after Obamacare was passed, there was such a backlash, especially in the red states, that those blue dogs were wiped out. And so Democrats today, they don't trust them as far as they can throw them. And that's what Kay Hagan's actions reveal, and rightfully so. Well, Chris Matthews is looking for a hero. Well, Chris, you're looking in all the wrong places. Obama never was and never will be a hero. You are listening to Dr. Grace, the editor of Politics and Culture at WorldTribune.com, upholding values that will never, ever die.
The stories that matter, the issues that count. This is American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
You're listening to the best of American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
This is American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
Welcome back to American Heartland with Dr. Grace. I'm the editor of Politics and Culture at WorldTribune.com. This week, there was no escaping it. Did you see Beyonce and Jay-Z in a really racy number at the 56th Annual Grammy Awards? It was all over the news. If you actually missed the show, you couldn't miss the headlines about it. Well, this week in World Tribune, I have an article. It begins with Beyonce and Jay-Z, and then it takes us back in time to other couples who have done the same thing. First, I want to describe what happens. Beyonce, a fabulous pop singer, one, by the way, that I have seen in concert. I think she's stunning. I think she's talented. I think she's quite remarkable. Yet, the performance was horrible. She was in a really scanty outfit, otherwise known as lingerie, gyrating on the stage in a way that was extremely provocative. And her husband, Jay-Z, and by the way, it took her 6 years to get him to put a ring on it. She dated him and since about 2002, and then they got married in 2008, now have a child together. Well, he came out on stage as they sang Drunken Love together. Roll it, Brittany.
If I do say so myself, if I do say so myself, if I do say so myself. Hold up, stumbled all in our house, time to back up all of that mouth that you had all in the car. Talking about you the baddest chick thus far. Talking about you be repping that third. I want to see all the things that I heard. No, I slink Clint Eastwood. Hope you can't handle this curve. Poor playing a four-gay. Messed up my wall hall. Strip friends right to the side. Ain't got time to take drugs off on sight.
All right, so the lyrics are really racy. The two are rubbing bodies together. They're talking about their drunken love, and they're talking about their lovemaking, et cetera, et cetera. And at this point, he's even starting to grab some of that rear end. And Beyonce had initially started the song very, very, very provocative moves, provocative poses. I mean, beyond what she has ever, ever done before. And it kept going with these really, really racy lyrics of how much sexual prowess she has, how drunk, crazy in love they are. It's so crazy, it's so wild, it's so remarkable. And the crowd went crazy too. Roll it, Brittany.
Body's hope, no rest under these lies. Boy, I'm drinking. Good, good.
crowd goes crazy, and here they are celebrating the song, celebrating how beautiful Beyonce is. Oh, this couple, they seem to have it all, right? Time magazine has once listed them as one of the most powerful couples in the industry, in the music industry. And all of this to say they obviously have such a passionate romantic relationship. What is Dr. Grace Vuoto's take on this? Marriage is in big, big trouble. Check out my piece in World Tribune because, you see, once you get to be about my age, I'm 43, I've seen this playbook before. Do you remember Kim Basinger, the beautiful model-turned-actress? Well, she married Alec Baldwin, another really dashing actor. And back in the day, they were the talk of Tinseltown, talented, beautiful. He starred with her in a movie called The Getaway. And he showcased how beautiful she was in a very vivid graphic sex scene. And what did this tell us about their relationship? That it was strong and solid and their marriage was good as can be? They divorced shortly thereafter. Another famous couple, Demi Moore and Bruce Willis. So beautiful, so talented, so good looking together on that red carpet. Married for a long time, about 11 years. And although Demi Moore had achieved great success as an actress in movies like Ghost, for which she won a Golden Globe, An Indecent Proposal, and A Few Good Men, she nonetheless decided to go down this road of public nudity, even though she was married and a mom of three. She posed nude on the cover of Vanity Fair, pregnant, 7 months pregnant, and that caused a national stir. The year after, she posed nude again, but this time in a bodysuit on Vanity Fair, and that caused another national stir. And then she did a movie striptease where in that promo, she was basically in the buff, and the movie was very, very provocative, showing her in various stages of undress. And what did all this steam and sex appeal mean for the marriage? Went bust. They divorced. Another couple, Nicole Kidman and Tom Cruise. Two A-listers, beautiful, talented, remarkable, sexy, everybody said. And what did they do? They appeared in a movie together in 1999, Eyes Wide Shut. Steamy sex scene. Everybody was talking about it. What happened to this couple? Divorce shortly thereafter. Another couple, more recent, Mark Anthony and Jennifer Lopez. On an American Idol finale, they did a really steamy number on stage, so much so that Ryan Seacrest said, "Whoa, you know, you've given us a window into how steamy things are at home." What happened to Mark Anthony and J-Lo? Divorced shortly thereafter. And last year, we talked about Miley Cyrus, nude here and nude there, wrecking ball video, all naked, and so much nudity. What was the undercurrent of all that? She was reeling from the implosion of her relationship with Liam Hemsworth, her fiancé, and eventually that went bust. So what's my take on Jay-Z and Beyoncé? They have marital problems. Because if you look at the past, look at this track record, usually when a couple has to go out there in public to show to the whole world just how hot and heavy they are behind closed doors, you know one thing. There's not much action going on behind closed doors. And my advice to Beyonce and Jay-Z is this. If you're still married by next year, the 57th Annual Grammy Awards, stay home and burn those fires at home for the sake of your marriage. Otherwise, you'll end up another statistic in the long, long road of Hollywood and music industry, broken dreams and broken marriages, punctuated by nudity and sexual expression that has no place in the public arena. You are listening to a middle-aged, wise, been there, done that, and seen it a couple of times,
Dr. Grace, the editor of Politics and Culture. Check out my piece on this story at worldtribune.com and listen every week as I uphold values that will never, ever die.
Here's what I tell everyone. I was born by God's dear grace in an extraordinary place, where the stars and stripes and the eagle fly. It's a big old land with countless dreams, and happiness ain't out of reach. Hard work pays off the way it should. Yeah, I've seen enough to know that we've got it good.
The stories that matter, the issues that count. This is American Heartland with Dr. Grace.
You're listening to the best of American Heartland with Dr. Grace.